I have a confession. When I was young, I really didn't get computer science. I'd been coding for a while before I dove into CS, and in your first CS lessons, they show you how to sort a list of numbers. And I remember thinking to myself, I'm never going to use this in the real world. 2 decades later, I have way more insight. I was an early employee at Twitter, I was a technical consultant on the TV show Silicon Valley, and now I build my own apps for a living, including 2019's iPhone App of the Year, Spectre. You know what? I was right. I've never had to write a sorting algorithm. But at the same time, I disagree with the idea that computer science is overrated, that you never use it in the real world. So I thought I'd make some videos to my younger self showing how I use computer science. And today, I want to talk about blurs. Blurs come up all the time in modern apps. It could be your designer wants you to blur the background of a screen, or in our case, our camera app Halide includes a portrait effect, which requires blurring part of the background. The good news is, it's easy to blur an image. Every modern graphics framework includes a blur effect right out of the box. The bad news is, it needs to run fast. Really fast. Anything longer than 1/30th of a second causes choppy video or animation. Now, you'll find that mild blurs run fast, but the more you blur an image, the slower it runs. I want to find a sweet spot where the image looks just blurry enough to look good, but not so blurry that we start to drop frames. And rather than guess at values, I'm going to use a tool to measure how long it takes to render each frame as I make things blurrier. Interesting. The relationship isn't a straight line. As I crank up the blurriness, it gets exponentially slower. So if I go from 1 to 2, it doesn't take twice as long, it takes 4 times as long. And if I go from 1 to 3, it takes 9 times as long. And this is an extremely common problem in software development. You start out with a fast algorithm, but then you find out under load that it grows disproportionately slow. This is so common, it has a name, quadratic complexity. And I've actually included a link in the description to a Tumblr that blogs about accidentally quadratic algorithms. They happen all the time. The good news is we don't need to go out and invent our own new blur algorithm. This is a solved problem. You see, we've been using a Gaussian blur, which is a high-quality blur, but if we're willing to sacrifice a little bit of quality, we can get significantly faster results. And the way that we do this is by Googling blur linear time. What, you think I memorize algorithms? This is coding, not a spelling bee. So, for our real-time preview, we'll use a lower quality but higher performant blur. After the user taps the capture button, we'll switch over to a higher quality blur because we're rendering the image in the background and the user won't notice the hit on performance. So, how does blurring work? To create a blurred image, you go through your original image pixel by pixel, and you replace each pixel with a blurred version. The way that you create that blurred version is by combining the pixels that surround it. Now, the math for combining them doesn't really matter. What matters is the more you combine, the blurrier the image. That's why it's called the blur radius, or the size of the window of all the pixels that you're going to be combining together. Now, let's look at why this algorithm is quadratic. If you're looking at a blur radius of 1, you're combining 8 surrounding pixels. If you're looking at a blur radius of 2, you're combining 24 surrounding pixels. 3, you're combining 48 surrounding pixels, and so on. The faster algorithm takes a much different approach. Rather than use one slow blur, it combines 2 really fast blurs. First, it blurs the image horizontally, and then it takes that blurred image and blurs it again vertically. The reason that these directional blurs are fast is that when you're only blurring in a single direction, you only need to look at in front of and behind the original pixel. So for a blur radius of 2, you're only looking at 4 pixels. For a blur radius of 3, you're only looking at 6 pixels, or 12 pixels total for our Gaussian blur approximation. And the results are pretty indistinguishable. And there you go, one example of computer science in the real world. Now you might say, if this is a solved problem, isn't there just some library I could drop into my app? Like, do I really need to know how a blur works? And in the real world, yeah, you can get away with using someone else's code without understanding the underlying implementation. Sometimes. And sometimes you need to weigh the different trade-offs between two different algorithms. And sometimes you're going to be asked to customize an algorithm for a desired effect. See, I don't think that computer science is about memorizing solutions. But if there's a single point I'm trying to get across today, it's that it's impossible to Google an answer unless you understand the question.